Yes, sir, we promised you a great
gorgeous George. Here
Freddie Blassie, the maker of champions.
Andre, the giant.
WrestleMania.
Everyone has a
place. Ladies and gentlemen, it is electric.
Hey, this is my
the champ is here.
I'm a guy, for all intents and purposes, never should have even made it to the WWE. I've had roadblock after roadblock after roadblock thrown in my way. But not only did I get past those roadblocks, I did it while flipping off the people who put up those roadblocks. I feel I have a responsibility to the younger wrestlers on the roster, the ones who aren't signed yet, and the future of pro wrestling as a whole to help make this place better and to change this place. I certainly can't change it by sitting on my couch in Chicago.
It feels so weird to me. It's like a so start from the beginning kind of thing.
Sure.
It's like a Freudian, tell me about your mother. And I'm like, my relationship with my family was never super good. And I never got what I needed from my blood family. I was always neglected or, you know, whatever. This isn't crying. This isn't therapy hour. I could care less. But I watched, you know, my parents, when my brother turned 16, buy him a new car. My brother had the opportunity to go to college and flunked out and spent all their money. You know, like, so, like, things like that. But, like, I was never afforded those. I always kind of thought I was, like, adopted. Like, maybe I was from outer space or something like that. Space boy tattoo. I always just found it weird that, like, you know, parents could have a kid and not, like, just 100% fully support them, like, in anything they wanted to do, you know? And I watched all the resources and everything go to the brother who stole from me, and I was just like, peace out. Like, I'm out of here, you know? And I don't even say adopted. I just showed up one day, like, at Chez's place and was like, I need a place to stay, you know? And I'm not saying this is gonna be for 2 days or 3 days or 3 months. Like, I can't, I'm not going home, you know? Like, I have no home.
He's always had a really hard relationship with his mom. They've always been really distant. They never got along. He slept at my parents' house all the time.
I sort of became adopted by Chez's family.
As long as I can remember, he's always been a very integral part of my life, I would say.
He's such a part of the family. The holidays, you know, Christmas mornings, it was sort of a natural thing.
With his parents, you know, I know that he does love his, you know, his biological parents. but they aren't close.
I am the kind of person who, like, if I'm not getting something that I need from somewhere, like, to me, I don't cry about it. I just, okay, well, I'm gonna go here and find what I need. The stuff with my dad having problems with alcohol was 100% real, you know? Like, he never beat me or my mom or, like, anything like that, but I just would always be like, well, man, he looks like he's miserable right now. Why would you do that to yourself? Like, it doesn't look like fun. It's pretty heavy stuff, but I remember one time, this is real life, you know? I remember one time my dad, like, being like extremely late to pick me up for like Little League, which is also probably a criminal sin because he was an assistant coach. So, and he picked me up in his work van. He's an electrician. And, you know, I remember like driving home and like, he's throwing up like the whole time. He's just like driving and just like, yeah. And I was a kid and like, I didn't know anything about anything. I was just like, holy crap. I just remember getting on my bike when I got home and like riding away, just like in tears, just like, please don't let it be cancer. Please don't let it be cancer. You know, like, because I didn't know, you know, and it was just, that was like the cycle of life. You know, that was a very eye-opening experience. Okay, you drink, that's what happens to you. I'm never drinking. It doesn't make any sense. That does not look like fun. And it horrified me. School was always weird for me because I guess I could always be classified as a nerd because I would wear comic book t-shirts and old punk rock t-shirts, and everyone just made fun of me because I had like one pair of shoes and one pair of jeans, and I'd wear the same stuff all the time. Obviously, that sort of carried over into adult life. I remember like wanting to fit in, but I mean, never fitting in like anywhere. You know, I realized very young that, like, you know, these jeans aren't going to make me cool. And if those people want to hang out with me because of what I'm wearing, I don't want to hang out with them anyway, you know? And you just find all these like-minded people in bands or in different schools, like, all over the world. And they share the same beliefs. And I remember reading a Maximum Rock and Roll one time when I was in detention. And it was, you know, I was into Minor Threat. And big interview about being straight edge and all that in the Maximum Rock and Roll. And I was like, well, okay, I could hang out with those guys because they obviously don't give a damn what I wear or what I look like, and we all don't have to drink. Awesome. I get it. Okay, I'm straight edge. It's something I identified with, so I grabbed it and I ran with it.
The straight edge lifestyle is kind of an offshoot, you know, of the punk rock thing. It's just a total DIY culture. You know, you beat to your own drum, you do what you want, you can make whatever happen, and it's up to you. It's not up to what society says. That universally speaks for CM Punk as a human being, as well as punk, the culture.
When you kind of gravitate towards punk rock and stuff like that, you kind of feel like a freak, and you don't really fit into like the kind of normal, clicked up things in high school.
I liked stuff that wasn't cool, comic books and pro wrestling and Frankenstein and Universal Monster movies.
And I think that's tough, you know, for anybody. For me, I found music. For him, I know he found music. He found that kind of stimulation to kind of go, oh, okay, everything's cool. He also found wrestling, too.
The infamous story now that's been beaten into the ground is me seeing Roddy Piper smash a coconut over Jimmy Snuka's head. And truth be told, like, I don't even know if that's the first time I saw wrestling, you know? I certainly couldn't have seen it, like, as it happened. That was, like, the moment. The coconut over the head and the trash talking and Roddy Piper was just like, man, that's me. Look at this guy on TV. Nobody likes him. Look at me. Nobody likes me. He wears a skirt. People make fun of him for the way he dresses. People make fun of me for the way I dress. He's not the biggest guy, but he's got the biggest mouth. Holy crap. I'm Roddy Piper. I guess that was my ticket. I'm going to be Roddy Piper, and I'm going to have all the money, and I'm going to wear a skirt and piss people off. You know, like, who cares? I'm very into pissing people off. And I saw this guy doing it and making money. I was sold. And I was about maybe 15 years old. I became good friends with my buddy Larry, who I worked with. And he was like, hey, we're going to do this wrestling federation in my backyard. You know, and I was like, well, I'm in, clearly. You know, I was like, well, you want to do something, you do it yourself. My meager beginnings were very, very punk rock, because it was just like, well, hey, you know, instead of, you know, eventually parents get upset, you're digging four giant holes in their backyard to stick posts in and, you know, tie yarn around for ropes, and a bunch of kids get together and decide, well, you know what, let's build a ring. You know, and I don't know who it is, but then one day somebody's like, well, we should charge admission. We call ourselves the LWF, we're the Lunatic Wrestling Federation.
And they had this, like, horribly dangerous makeshift ring, nobody do this at home type of thing, that they somehow assembled in the backyard, and literally we sat on bales of hay.
The crowd started growing. We literally started drawing, like, 200, 300 people. Like, it was ridiculous.
Every week they would go to his shows. The night before, Friday night, they'd be making signs in the house, you know, that every single time.
Those were awesome. Like, those are some of the best memories I have of watching him wrestle. They're just so fun.
It felt like the biggest thing that was happening at school, and, like, none of these guys even went to our school. Like, these were, like, the surrounding schools, but, like, Monday, you know, if you're walking through the hallways, it was like, oh, are you at the LWF show? And like, did you see what, you know, so-and-so did? And it felt big.
Everybody in Chicago called us backyarders, said we were untrained. But the funny thing is we went to their shows. We would go to their shows and just heckle the crap out of them. There'd be 10, 15, on a good night, there'd be 30 people.
I was 17 and working a show in Chicago for PWI, and CM Punk's with the LWF. They were the Rebels. They were doing their own shows. They were self-trained guys. They used to come heckle our shows, and mayhem broke out somewhere out of the ring, and out of nowhere, CM Punk sits next to me and puts his arm around me and says, "We're taking over, kid."
And we were doing shows, and we were supposedly the clueless, untrained backyard guys, and we were drawing 900 to 1,000 people. It completely unheard of.
He was the guy. You always heard CM Punk through wrestling hotlines. I just never went out to see it. We always heard that they were just rebellious, and, you know, it was dangerous because they were self-trained guys.
All the local wrestlers hated us. We weren't trained. So then it stuck in my head, like, well, wait a second. There's truth to what they're saying. You know, if we've done this without supposedly knowing anything, like, if we take the spirit of that but actually learn our craft, like, man, how unstoppable would we be? And that's where the friction happened. The big thing of contention was my brother, he was in charge of all the money. We started running real shows. So then now you're talking about, like, insurance and security deposits for buildings and renting guardrails, renting chairs. You know, one day it was like he stole all the money. It wasn't like a small chunk of change for a bunch of kids that were just goofing off, running, you know, pirate pro wrestling shows. Like, it was a lot of money. And a lot of people to this day are like, oh, it's your brother. And I'm like, really? You ever steal from your brother? You know, like, that's not what brothers do, man. Brothers help each other, you know? Like, Toby from H2O, he's my brother. Lars Fredriksson, he's my brother. These are dudes that love and support me, you know? They don't steal from me. I haven't talked to them in like 12 years. It's real life.